This is KLEAN Radio.
Welcome everybody out there listening to KLEAN Radio, and a special hello to my co-host Andrew Spanswick, who's actually not here tonight. He his father died about 3 months ago, Roger Spanswick. And it's a pretty amazing story, actually. His father, who taught at Cornell, who was a professor for years, is getting an honorary chair at Cornell. And 2 years in a row, he was a Merit Award professor. He was nominated for, he was given the Merit Award for Best Professor, which is nominated by the students. And I've met him a bunch of times. He was an all-around amazing man. And to Helen Spanswick, to Andrew Spanswick, to the whole Spanswick family, it's pretty amazing, Jack. And in studio tonight is Jack Grisham, who's co-hosting tonight, and I'm actually wearing my Cornell sweatshirt that Andrew got me.
Very nice.
It is nice, you know. Everybody thinks I went to Cornell then when I wear it, and I'm like, nope, didn't get to Cornell. And so we're in studio tonight is Jack Grisham, returning to the show but co-hosting tonight, and Jack is from the legendary famous band known as T.S.O.L. And, you know, it's amazing, Jack. I got to tell you, every time I tell people TSOL, they know it. And, you know, I grew up in New York. I grew up in the 80s listening to my sister's music. So I grew up listening to Lionel Richie and Bon Jovi. And I wasn't really that familiar with TSOL. But
I like Lionel.
But apparently you guys are huge.
Yeah, I don't know about that. I don't know. Whatever. Well known.
You're very well known, but you're very influential in that scene.
Yeah.
And you also... So that was, you know, and so we're talking about your show about addiction and recovery. TSOL, were you sober at the time, or did you get sober after?
No, not at the time. No. I was not. And I don't even know if you could call it an issue. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I really had an issue. I was like a binge drinker at that time. But I had the selfishness and self-centeredness since I was born. I hear some people go, hey, I've been sober longer than I've been drinking. I will never be sober longer than I've been thinking. So it's just not going to happen.
And, you know, it's funny because I got sober. You were sober very young. You got sober young. I got sober young. I was 22 when I got sober. These days, that's old.
Right.
You know, you have a lot, you know, people are getting sober 15, 16, 17, which is amazing. You know, and, you know, I always like to say I did more stupid stuff sober than I've ever done drunk. But I've also had fun in sobriety, you know, and that's one of the topics I wanted to touch upon in tonight's show. You know, we talk a lot of, you know, there's good things about sobriety is you talk some deep issues with people. You get into some really, you know, but sometimes we forget that this is about having fun. It's about living a life.
Yeah, exactly. I can real quick, I'll give you a great story. I'm not going to say what band this guy is in now, but he wasn't in a band when I met him. I'm out in Jacksonville, Florida, and this guy's in a meeting, and he's talking about, he's in some 12-step meeting. He's saying he's going to kill himself, right? He goes, I'm done. I'm miserable. I can't take it. And he looks legitimate. Like, I'm looking at him. I'm thinking, hey, this guy's, like, just going to whack himself off after the meeting. So I walk up and say, hey, look, you're gonna take yourself out. He goes, what do you care, man? I go, give me 2 weeks. He goes, what? I go, give me 2 weeks, man. Why don't you just get in the car and come with me right now? Because I was on a trip, and he's like, what do you mean get in the car? He goes, I got a job. I go, look, you're going to kill yourself, dude. Screw the job. He goes, well, let me go to the apartment and get some clothes. I go, no, no clothes. Come with what's on your back. You're going to kill yourself or get in the car? He goes, all right, get in the car. Guy hung with me for 2 weeks. I took him driving around the country, going to shows, and just showed him, like, look, you can basically have a blast being sober. And the guy was just incapable of seeing it at the time, and now he's gone on. He's in the big rock band, and he's traveling all over the world, and married.
And he's having fun.
Yeah, exactly.
And, you know, I think a lot of people, by the way, if you just tuned in, you're listening to KLEAN Radio in the studio tonight with Jack Grisham. Go to facebook.com/KLEAN Radio or go to at KLEAN Radio on Twitter. And tonight I'm told the hashtag is sober fun. I've never actually given a hashtag before. I'm new to this whole hashtag thing. And I do think it's so important to talk about. I think it's so important because, you know, when you're in rehab or you're drinking and your ideas of when you're drinking, your ideas of fun are so distorted. You know, I would laugh at the things I had fun now. You know, if you told me I'd enjoy a museum, I would have thought, who enjoys museums? You know, people, rich people, you know, boring people enjoy museums, Jack. And I got to tell you, I like museums.
Yeah, I love. But I don't know if you can just tell somebody that's brand new, just say, hey, have a good time.
Show
There's got to be some shift.
Yeah.
Like, I know for me, it was being sober was a drag.
Yeah.
I mean, I walked in to like the rooms that people go to. I walked in and said, this is it. My life's over, man. This is where I ended up. Yeah. Everything I have done, records, traveling, has ended me up right here, sitting next to some dude that's got crap in his pants. It's just bad news, man. It's like I was in purgatory for years before I woke up.
And, you know, it's interesting you say that because I heard somebody says, you know, the old thing of, you know, I said to somebody, I'm bored. And they said, you know why? And I said, why? And they said, because you're boring. And I think when we get sober, we do have we are very boring people. Drinking and using is an extremely boring thing. You know, it could look like, you know, when you being in the music business and, you know, being rock people. I know when you're living in it I don't see the fun. It wasn't fun.
Right.
It shows an image of fun of, you know, you see these, you know, musicians just having a blast. What you think is a blast. Most of them are miserable.
At the end.
Yeah. At the end.
I had some good days too, man. Right. Yeah. When it was working, it was good.
Right.
We do the parade, 4th of July, Huntington Beach Parade, biggest west of the Mississippi. I'm out there. I got a newcomer guy with me, and we're sitting there watching a parade. It's like 7 in the morning. There's a guy across the street. He's hammered. Hammered. He's got his pants, no shirt on, pants hanging down so low that they're basically just hanging on the tip. You know what I mean? It's like a little fish hook holding his pants up, right? He's got a girl under each arm, a Corona in each hand. I'm 50 yards away. I can see the sweat dripping off the Coronas. This new guy sitting next to me goes, sure glad I'm not drinking. Like, what about that? Doesn't look fun, man.
But that's the thing. It does look fun.
Right.
And you're right. And listen, we drank because many times it was fun until it stopped becoming fun.
You bet.
But the non-fun really in the end outweighs the fun.
Yes,
you know, it's those few fun memories. I mean, essentially that's what it was. You know, they call it an addiction chasing the dragon, you know, right. And we were chasing that one or two times, those one or two great times. And, you know, and I've got to tell you the greatest moments I've had in my life. And I'm not saying this because it's just, you know, we talk about sobriety. Some of the greatest times of my life are sober. You know, I could never have jumped out of a plane. Yeah, it wouldn't have, you know, jumping out of a plane sober was one of the greatest experiences of my life.
Right. But I think for me, I think it's important also to let new people know, hey, we get it that you did have fun, though. Like one of the worst quotes you ever hear is guys will say, oh, my worst day sober is better than my best day drinking. That's crazy. It's a misquote, too. The quote is, I wouldn't my old life, although not a bad one.
Yeah.
I wouldn't trade my life today for my life then. And that's a big difference. We're talking two different things here. So, you know, whatever. The end was no good.
Without a doubt. And if you just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio. That's Jack Grisham co-hosting instead of Andrew tonight. And we're talking about having sober fun and sobriety. So give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. Something else I wanted to talk about. In the Northeast, they're having every area is riddled now with drugs. And, you know, specifically in New Jersey area, they're having a huge issue with heroin. And Richie Sambora, who's a really good guy. And you know him.
I like Richie.
And
he's
a great guy.
Yeah.
And he made actually a song about addiction, about what it's like to shoot up.
Is he still recording it? Jesus, sorry, Jim.
That's actually a rough cut. And it's actually coming out on iTunes pretty soon, and all the proceeds are being given to help the heroin problem. And here's the thing, and it's you know, there's so many mothers and there's so many families that have lost people to addiction, to heroin, through all these things. And, you know, growing up in the 80s, we had the Nancy Reagan, you know, the Just Say No, and... you know, when I see something like this with Richie Sambora, and it breaks my heart because it's something we're talking about. Say with Gandhi, right? He had a great line that I heard years, you know, great line that I heard years ago. He came up with it a few years before me. And it was, you know, if you're going to take something away from somebody, you have to give them something of equal or greater importance. And, you know, we're talking about one of the things that when somebody gets sober, we have to give them something. We have to give them something more than just not drinking.
Right.
You know, more than just staying off of drugs. You know, more than just saying no. And it's like what you were doing with that newcomer that's in that band that's doing amazing. You showed him fun.
Right.
You showed him that you gave him something to replace what was taken away.
Yeah, well, I felt worse. Like for me, I felt worse. When I got sober, it was worse. Like, it was one thing that I was taking a beating, but I'd been taking a beating for years. But when all of a sudden I'm sober and now wide awake, unbearable. Unbearable. It was worse after I stopped until, like you said, something replaced it. Until that purpose, that spiritual change, that psychic change came in, whatever the hell it was. You know, just being sober to an addict or an alcoholic, bad news.
Right.
Bad news.
Because you're not living life. And you're not having, in a sense, you know, and I'm going to say this again, you're not having sober fun. And the reason I bring that up, it was so important to me. When I was 17 years old, I was in rehab in Israel. And I had a drug counselor that took us to a concert. He took us to Radiohead opened for REM. And we go to this concert, and this drug counselor was a wild guy. He was like 50 years old. He blew on his pinky all the time because he had done so many drugs. And I remember he goes to me during the show, he goes, "You're not going to stay sober. You're probably not going to stay sober, but you'll never be able to say it wasn't fun."
Oh, that's
and,
great. Yeah.
And it had such a lasting impact on me because he was right. I was never able to, like, say to drink again and to do that stuff and say, you know, it wasn't fun. You know, I didn't, you know, and because we hear that all the time. Why get sober? You know, you're boring people. You know, why do I want to be with, and there's actually one of my favorite chapters in one of the literature is like, it says that. It says you're going to say, am I going to become boring like some righteous people right. I know? And it's really important that, you know, people learn what fun is and finding your own fun. Because your and my fun might be totally different. I'm pretty sure it is in some ways. You know, you have a fun life, Jack.
Yeah, but it's mellow. I mean, what I do for fun is really mellow. I like walking, I like going to the beach. I like reading, going to movies. I mean, that's, but I've always been like that. You know,
but you've recently got married.
Oh, I love it.
You know, you know what I mean?
I got five kids.
You have five,
five kids.
You have the almost Brady bunch.
Well, we got Uncle Kevin too. So we got the bunch.
You got the bunch. Them all. Yeah. But you have a new book coming out called Cold Blue, A Love Story. You've written a couple books. You know, you're doing all these things that I consider fun.
Right.
You're living life.
Yeah. And they're too much. Yeah. Almost too much. I mean, there's so much to do. It's like you said, when people say, hey, if you're boring, you know, if you're bored, you're boring. It's like I have never ran out of stuff to do since I woke up being sober. I mean, movies and books and shows and go and play. There's not enough time in the day. I mean, I seriously sleep maybe 4 hours a day.
When I was a newcomer and I used to hear people say there's not enough time in the day, I'd be like, I get so mad. I'd be living my life right now. I got so many hours when I was new. And I hear people say like you, there's not enough hours. And they'd be like, take my life. I got plenty of hours and nothing to do other than go to meetings. And that's what I needed to do. And if you just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio, give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. In studio tonight with me is Jack Grisham. You know, vocalist from TSOL, author,
hypnotherapist,
husband, and sober since 1989.
Right.
Which is pretty amazing. I mean, that's almost 25 years. I mean,
it's over 25 years.
It's over 25 years. that's nuts.
That's crazy.
that's insane.
Yeah, but it was, but now it's like, there was one thing that you brought up that people get confused when they're getting sober and then they think they want to drink. Like I deal with a lot of people and they go, oh, I want to drink. I want to drink. And what I realize is it's because their definition of alcohol or drugs hasn't changed yet. The emotional definition. They think they're going to get relief or fun from drugs and alcohol when in reality, they're not. They're going to go back to jail, crap their pants, and probably end up in an alley with their wrist slit is what's going to happen.
That's best case scenario. Yeah,
and that never sounds good. So the minute I came and started realizing that was where that was going to take me, I started looking for that relief of being uncomfortable in other places.
And, you know, it's very interesting also because, you know, tonight we're talking about sober fun. So that's hashtag, I have to say it, hashtag sober fun. But one of the things that I learned very early on in sobriety was saying yes. You know, people would ask me, like, let's go do this. My first thing is to say no, you know, when I'm not the only one, you know, for me, listening to the air around my head in my house is way more fun than being scared of finding something new to do. And I learned to say yes. And because I said yes, I learned these new fun experiences as a sober person. You know, people would ask, let's go somewhere. And I'd be like, yes, you know, and I'd end up in Pennsylvania, you know, doing something. And, you know, so I want to hear from the people out there. What are your ideas of sober fun? Give us a call. Jack's ideas are walking, hiking, being married, living a productive life.
Right, and we do. Yeah. I was going to say, and just when you're sober, you don't got to always hang out with sober people. there's a lot of like normies or whatever doing stuff. Like I teach a writing class at my house on Wednesday nights, and it's half normie, half people in the program. And the normies don't even know the people are on the program, and the people on the program think all the normies are on the program. Like no one had any idea that we're just a bunch of people in there.
So how old are your kids? How old is the oldest?
27. So 27, 14, 2 9-year-old identical twin boys and a 6-year-old girl.
So one of the things that I would really want to get into very quickly, just through the summer, is, you know, graduations are coming up. Parents have kids going to college. Binge drinking's on the rise as always. How did you deal with that as a sober person when
my daughter's still binge drinking. It hasn't stopped. They woke up around 1 o'clock today, and I heard her boyfriend go, "Yeah, I'm just trying to get it together after last night."
Does it scare you?
Yeah, a little bit, but you know, I mean, what can you say? I mean, you set
an
example.
Well, that's the question. What can you say? Because there are tons of parents out there. I'm sure you have dialogue with your daughters. What do you say?
I don't know. I don't come down on them. I mean, I wasn't going to listen. I mean, they know where I come from. They've been to meetings with me. They've seen it. I mean, the one thing that I think they get a real taste of that a lot of parents don't get is my kids see a lot of death. I was reading this figure here on this overdose figure, which is so way low to me. It's like my kids have seen Uncle Craig die, Uncle Jack die, you know, Uncle Rory die. They have seen these people die, and it's a lot of deaths. You know, and they really get a taste of the negative side of it, too. Now, is that going to stop anyone? No, that's frothy emotional appeal, and it doesn't work.
I don't think death ever scares people.
No,
death
never.
Does not scare addicts. Life does. You know, you tell an addict, you know, it's scaring. You're right. It's such a quagmire of what do you tell your kids? You know, and like you're saying, you don't come down on them, and you have a modicum of a dialogue.
Right.
At least you're hearing that conversation that's going on.
And to be there for them if they need help. I mean, there's another program that deals with that.
Yeah.
Like, you know, they feel bad enough already a lot of times. It's like, and then also trust. Trust in whatever power's out there is another big one for me. It's like to not sell fear to these guys, you know.
Yeah.
So, and also make it a safe place for them to come. It's like, that's one, if they're going to get yelled at, hassled, and jumped on, then when they're loaded and struggling, they're not coming to you.
And if you just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio. That's Jack Grisham. Let's get to Rich in Beaverton, Oregon. Welcome to Clean Radio, Rich.
Oh, well, thank you very much for taking my call. As I told the screener, this is the first that I'm kind of a latecomer, I guess. At first, I just tuned in and heard this discussion on the radio. I almost fell over.
It's serendipity.
I would have never dreamed that we would ever be discussing living life clean. On the radio.
And that's clean with a K, of course. And
exactly. I got clean in 1989 myself. I'll have 25 here coming up in August.
That's amazing. Congratulations.
And I can tell you that I've been here ever since I got here. While I walked through the doors, and by the grace of God, I'm still here today. But I will tell you that in the early years, in the early days, it's very hard. And not that as we gain more time clean and living this life, which is more than, as you know, just not using. It's a whole learning process. But not to say that you can't have problems or that life on life's terms doesn't come and knock on the door with years clean.
So what do you do for fun?
Well, what I do, and you mentioned it before, is we have to learn these things. So slowly over a period of time, I adapted my way of living back into this so-called society. I got into hiking, mountain biking, things that I was doing before, struggling to try to do before. I could never participate with anyone because I just wasn't reliable. I couldn't follow through. But I got back into hiking. I got back into mountain biking, the different activities. But I did it with other people that were about the same business of recovery, you see. So that was what I had to do. I couldn't hang out with the other people. I had to be around other people that were in recovery.
You know, then I asked, you know, that's a really good point. I'm actually, one of the reasons I wanted to talk about this tonight, Jack, and Rich is because starting Wednesday nights in the Valley, Clean, and we're doing a Clean League. We're doing a Clean Summer Bowling League. And Pins has been great, and it's open to the sober community. You know, we're starting a bowling league. And, you know, it's free for people, in the beginning at least. And, you know, we're going to be bowling Wednesday nights from 7 to 9. And it's really important. It's really important for when you're new to have a community, to have, you know, we would go to the diner after meetings, a bunch of us. And I remember those experiences and people hanging out with me for fun and for free. And so if you're in LA, and we want to actually, we're probably going to start this pretty soon in Oregon too, is we're going to start a clean league. You know, so that people know Wednesday nights, I could go to Pins in the Valley and go, you know, and be amongst a sober community.
Yeah, that's a great idea. And again, we got involved with that as a fellowship, whatever, wherever you go in that community, the meetings, that fellowship, that area has events. They have clean events. They have bowling leagues. They have, we had a softball league going on. And so other areas within our region would also play in this softball league, and we would do this year after year. But we would, as a group, as a fellowship, as a community, we would be going and announcing these things, and we'd be going to movies, and we'd be doing these activities, and we would make sure that we brought the newcomers along, because, again, you have to learn this new way of life. It's not something where you just... You stop using, and then all of a sudden, boom, you're a productive member of society.
It takes and it takes a long time, like Jack said. It takes an experience, a psychic change. And Rich, we got to run. Can you do us a favor, though? Go to facebook.com/cleanradio and like us. And, yeah, and keep in touch, Rich, anytime.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you. And that was Rich calling from Beaverton, Oregon, First time actually I ever heard the show, and he's amazed. And I got to tell you, Jack, I think it's pretty amazing. You got sober in 1989. If somebody would have told you we'd be talking about on the radio having a clean, sober time, probably you wouldn't have thought that was the case.
No, not really. No, and you know, and real quick, a lot of stuff, I wasn't a group guy. Like for me, when I got clean, I wasn't a group guy. So I had a couple of friends. Like I had a couple of guys that surfed. That I hung out with, a couple of guys that we went to movies together, we ate together after the meeting, you know. So
you found your clique.
Exactly. So you don't necessarily have to jump in the big volleyball game or whatever.
Right.
You know, you can find people
that think like you.
There's
different strokes
for
different folks. You want to find the guys that go to the diners, the guy that go to the events, the woman. You could find anything you want in 12 steps. And if you just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio. I bet. So they just came out with this thing, the top four expensive abnormal addictions, Jack.
And yeah, I love it.
I don't know. You're the perfect person to ask that to, but we'll get the answers when we come back. If you just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio. We'll be back pretty soon.
Are you or someone you care about addicted to drugs or alcohol? Addiction ruins lives and destroys families. Bring an end to the pain and suffering by calling Clean Treatment Centers. Clean has helped people from around the world break free by not only treating the addiction, but the underlying causes and providing vital aftercare so people can get clean and stay clean with no gimmicks and no false promises. If you need immediate assistance or just have questions, call Clean Treatment Centers for guidance. A much better life awaits. Now back to Andrew Spanswick and Judah Friedman.
Welcome back to Clean Radio. In studio tonight, instead of Andrew, is the amazing, talented Delmer Buddy Totten. No, it's Jack Grisham. And Andrew's actually in New York. His father, Roger Spanswick, is getting the honorary chair at Cornell, which is it's such a cool thing, you know, to, you know, I've met Andrew's dad and he passed away a bit ago. And it's such an amazing thing to get a, you know, to get something like that, Jack. I want to get a chair one day. That's all I know. I'll take like, I don't even need a chair. Just give me a, I don't know, give me a stool.
Yeah, I don't know. I didn't spend a lot of time in college.
And
and
before we go to the break, we talked about the four of the most expensive abnormal addictions, Jack, and I want to know what you think they are. But before that, let's go to Buddy Totten, because hashtag sober fun tonight on Facebook. We've been posting this, and Buddy, what are some of the responses been?
Let's see. We posted having fun in sobriety. What are your favorite things to do now that you're clean and sober? And Mary says concerts. She never thought she would say that.
And that's a TSOL concert, by the way. And I hear they're great. Somebody actually I know, I'm not joking, saw you a couple weeks ago in concert. He said you guys are amazing.
Yeah, it's good.
Yeah. So yeah.
And then Frank says New York City and New York City Yankees games was there again yesterday. I'm 1 hour west of the city. I have made this trip all too many times, never knowing how I got home. Concerts as well. Freedom from bondage has happened for me.
That's amazing. And you know what, Frank? I got to say, Jack, that's an amazing point, because I got to tell you, one of the greatest gifts of sobriety is going to a concert, right, and waking up in the morning and knowing where your car is, knowing where you are, knowing where your driver's license is, and remembering the show. Exactly. I went to Billy Joel a couple weeks ago. I remember the show.
Yeah, that's great. I don't remember half of mine.
Oh, my. That you performed.
Wow, the ones you performed in.
You know,
wow.
It's amazing that you share that, is because years ago I heard Jerry Cooney speak, you know, the great fighter, and who's, you know, and he didn't remember fighting Foreman.
Right.
He didn't remember the fight. I think it was Foreman. And he didn't remember. And, you know, just like you don't remember. And that,
frightening. To leave the house and then wake up the next morning, like land in the bed and just realize, hey, I've been somewhere. And remembering you had a show but had no idea. I've seen photos of stuff when I was getting drunk, and then later I see it and I had no recollection of ever being there.
It's that's frightening.
Yeah.
And that's one of the greatest gifts of sobriety. People are always looking for spiritual experiences and spiritual awakenings. Pay for a full tank of gas. You know, for me, that was a spiritual experience. Remember where your car is. Definite spiritual awakening.
Yeah. Getting my license back.
Getting your license back.
Being able to argue with the police.
Yeah.
It was one thing. Normally, I'd get pulled over, arrested.
Right.
And then I got pulled over and I'd go to meetings, go, I got a ticket today. I got a ticket because I had no warrants.
Right.
And then it was, hey, I got pulled over and I argued.
Totally. Yeah, it's the greatest. Just, when you get sober,
you got
getting pulled over,
you got everything.
It's so
getting
awesome.
Pulled over sober is like, woohoo!
I love it.
Yeah.
Buddy, thank you so much.
Absolutely, thank you.
And until next week, Dumber Buddy Totten. And so, Jack, the four most expensive abnormal addictions, do you have any idea what they are?
I'm going to go one, plastic surgery.
And you would be...
seriously?
Dun, 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 dun. Yeah, no.
Oh, they're not counting that as an addiction?
I mean, that's... I guess it's not in mass.
Right.
So I'll say it. Number four is internet and texting. I don't see how that's possible, but that's what. And then number three is gaming. You know, people buying games and all these things. That's become an extremely expensive addiction. Xbox, PlayStation. Number two, shopping and spending, which a problem I don't have. Spending, yes, not shopping. And number one is energy drinks, which is frightening because we know a lot of people that spend a lot of money on energy drinks.
See, and I don't see any of those as a problem.
It's not a problem until it becomes one.
Yeah, exactly.
And so those are the four. And if you just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio in studio tonight with Jack Grisham. I want to get to a call very quickly. Let's get to Julie in Dallas. Welcome to Clean Radio, Julie.
Hi.
How are you, Julie?
I'm great.
How'd you hear about us in Dallas, Julie?
Oh, I'm on the Facebook, and I seen the post about calling in about sober ideas.
Okay, cool. For fun, yeah.
And recovery has given me the privilege to be a parent. So now that I'm in recovery and I can parent my children, I go to a lot of community health fairs, firecrackers or anything, and sports, baseball and soccer and Cub Scouts with my kids. And I pretty much stay away from the family and friends that are going to have cookouts where there's going to be alcohol there.
That's so important, Julie, that you talk about that, just what you're saying right now, because that's an incredibly important thing, Jack, too, is the people, places, and things when you first get sober. Is
very much so. Not only for us as a person in recovery, but the environment that we're going to have around our children so that they don't think it's normal.
See, it's... Yeah, for me, I a friend of mine, Paul, always says this. He drank the value out of booze. I mean, I drank the value out of it. I was 28 days sober, going to a show, and I had to go to a meeting first. I got 28 days sober. I'm going to play a concert, and I got a car full of drunks, and I'm driving them. And I pulled them up outside the meeting like a clown car, and I went inside the meeting, and I could hear them outside waiting for me to get done being sober so I could go to the show. I mean... I mean, for me, I was done.
Right.
It didn't matter. I'd be reading the paper while they're smoking.
That's an interesting thing you bring up too, because I you're right. I was done too. It didn't matter where I went, and I would go to Yankee games, and I would go to all this stuff. And it, honestly, I love that. What did you say? That's a great line. The value of
he drank the value out of booze.
That's an amazing line. And you know, yeah. So I'm sorry about your Dallas Cowboys, Julie.
I'm used to it.
And the Rangers aren't doing that well either. But Julie, I want to thank you so much for giving us a call. And if you can private message us, we'll send you some stuff over there in Dallas.
All right. Thank you so much. Stay blessed.
Okay. So Facebook us. Go to Facebook.com. You're there. Thank you, Julie. And that was Julie calling from Dallas, Texas. And if you just tuned in, you are listening to Clean Radio. An interesting story I saw a couple weeks ago. The reason I wanted to talk about this, Channing Tatum, very big actor, he's huge. And he was in an article, Jack, in an interview, he said he was a functioning alcoholic.
Nice.
And I remember when I was drinking, I used to say, yeah, I'm an alcoholic, you know, and I had no idea what I was talking about. I knew I had a problem, but I didn't know it was alcoholism. And I don't think people, you know, because I hear people say that sometimes that they're drinking, they go, oh, I know I'm an alcoholic. No, you don't. Because this is my opinion. I don't think you understand what alcoholism is.
Right.
That it's once you start, you can't stop for the most part.
And also it's the fact that it being whatever, we can argue this, whatever, about the fatal illness.
Right.
It's like I get on guys all the time. You can say you're an alcoholic, but it's one thing to say it. It's another thing to believe it.
Right.
You know, and I was a functioning alcoholic, too. I just wasn't functioning properly. I was doing a whole bunch of functioning. Yeah. It was always functioning.
But what is your, I mean, you know, and I hear that, and I have, you know, and I hear a bit of sadness for him, you know, he said something very striking to me. He said, you know, he's shooting a movie pretty soon, Magic Mike 2, which I know you and I are going to be the first two people to see.
Right.
And he actually said that he was not going to drink for those 4 months, you know, that he shoots the movie. And again, it's like one of those things we hear all the time is the bargaining, is the, you know, that whole thing. You know, for 4 months, I'm not going to do it.
But some people can
right.
do that. I mean, that's the thing to not go too much on either thing.
Right.
Some of these guys do show up.
Yeah.
But for me, that wasn't enough. My map of the world had totally become useless. I mean, just showing up, just getting drunk, there was nothing to it anymore.
And how, and the willpower, right, to say, you know what, one of the greatest things, and you said about, you know, you're talking, your life is so big right now. A big reason for that is because you're not focused and fixated on when the next drink or drug could come. When a drug addict or an alcoholic stops fixating on when their next fix is going to be, that opens up about 23 and a half hours in the day.
Yeah, it's like, what are you going to do?
Yeah, you have literally opened Pandora's box of hallelujah, there's life.
Right, but it's not. But it's also part of not just when the new guy comes in, he walks into the rooms and he sees basically just a room. That's it. It's when that changes and when you walk in the room and you see a doorway instead of a room, you say, "Hey, where can this take me?" It's like I've been all over the world. I remember I was swimming in a lake in the Swiss Alps one time and just looking around, saying, "Look, this is where I am now. This is what I'm doing, you know, on tour, going all." I was in a meeting in Buenos Aires. 2 weeks later, I'm in a meeting in Gothenburg, Sweden. You know, it's like all over the place and with the fam. My life is so full, but there's got to be that. To me, it almost seems like they need to be in purgatory a little bit
right.
before they wake up, you know, that little stretch.
Well, you got to get to hell before you get to heaven, to quote the great Don Henley.
Yes.
And if you just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio. I want to get to, we have a couple of calls lined up. I want to get to Marie. She's gone through something. Marie, welcome to Clean Radio. Welcome back to Clean Radio.
Hi, everybody.
How are you tonight, Marie?
Hi. Okay, how are you?
Good.
I had a question about, I'm having kind of some communication issues with my sponsor. Since I've been in recovery, I have now almost 2 years clean. Thank you. Since I've been in recovery, I've had some pretty devastating health issues come up, and it's really thrown me for a loop. And I have a really great sponsor, but she kind of seems to have this, I feel like I'm getting rushed by her to just hurry up and be happy, hurry up and come to that kind of moment where I just really, really am just, you know, totally appreciate my recovery and I'm so grateful, which I am. But however, these health issues have kind of gotten me down a bit, and she seems really upset that I'm not able to kind of come out of it and just be all, you know, fa-la-la recovery. I wish I could be that way. You know, I mean, she has another sponsee that has reached that moment and has dealt with a lot of her issues with her family, but these are health issues for me where I can't change them. And I've told her, I know I can't change these issues right now. You can't change these issues for me. You can't fix this for me, and I'm not expecting you to. But at the same time, I can't force myself to just be happy and be, you know, grateful all the time. And there's moments where I am grateful, but it's also been really tough. And I, she just seems agitated that I can't really get out of it. And so I just wanted to know if there's any way I can kind of have some better communication with her. If I don't want to censor myself in my step work, but I have to be honest about how I'm feeling.
Marie, you're actually asking a great question. And here's the thing. You know, Jack and I are both sober, and we've been through the ringer, I'm sure, of all this stuff. You're not alone in this boat. Here's the thing. My first couple years of sobriety, I was miserable. Okay? I wasn't always fun to be around. But the thing was, I found people that were okay with me not being fun to always be around. And they loved me no matter what. They loved me back to health. And they allowed me to be crazy. And they allowed me to be sick. And my suggestion to you is to find people in your life that are going to love you and like you and let you be as crazy and as sick and as wild and as fun and as all those things that you need to be. And that's my suggestion.
And get her a book on Al-Anon.
And get her a book on Al-Anon.
Read it.
That's exactly right. Marie, you know, we're not the wellness society.
But if I can bring up something, there was Dr. Paul. You know, everyone talks about Dr. Paul. Acceptance is the key to my problem.
In the 12-step world, everybody.
Exactly. 12-step world. Sorry. Yes. I used to call him and talk to him. And I asked him one day, because he was like a busy cat, right? So I asked him one day, I go, hey, Paul, do you mind me calling you? And he goes, Jack, if you're here to talk about the solution, I got all the time in the world for you. But if you're here to talk about the problem, you're going to have to find somebody else.
Right. But at least he said that to you with honesty, and he said it with love and compassion. And I think that's the biggest thing sometimes. And I feel that's what's missing, Marie, with your relationship. Listen, the sponsor thing sometimes could be rough. And I always joke with people and I say, you know, it's, you know, treat a sponsor sometimes like we're reverse sometimes when we get sober. We treat a sponsor like a relationship. And we treat our relationships like one night stands. You know, sometimes it's okay to treat your sponsor like if they're not working out for you after a couple days, maybe find somebody new.
Right.
You know, it's okay. And it's okay to do that. But here's the one thing I know, Marie, you should always feel safe.
Okay.
And that's really important. Okay. Because you've called a couple times, right?
Yeah.
And I know you seem like a great woman. You have a great career and you have. And listen, Jack, sometimes people get issues. They get physically sick.
Sure.
And they get all that stuff, Marie. You know, sometimes it's okay to start making your own decisions, big girl decisions, and reevaluate stuff.
Right.
You know, we're not drones when we get sober. We can reevaluate. We don't all wear the same underwear, you know. And okay, Marie?
Okay.
Let me ask you a question. What are you going to do for Sober Fun? What do you do?
I guess I don't know. I'm still kind of just trying to figure out how to balance my recovery life and then my regular life. So I think at this point I'm really just trying to stick with my recovery community and more focused on that really than anything, and then just, you know, work and stuff like that.
I think it's time Marie starts having a little fun, Jack.
Yeah.
Marie, this is the year we're going to focus on you having some fun.
Yeah, San Jose's good. Go over the Winchester house.
Yeah, you got a hockey team there. You got concerts there all the time, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Bands make it to San Jose, right?
Yeah, cruise over to Santa Cruz to sit in a hot tub for a while in the tea gardens. Great. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to be going to Santa Cruz this summer. So.
Okay.
That's something.
I want you to tell us something, Marie. When you go and have fun, call us back and tell us how it was.
Okay.
And good luck with the issues you're going through.
And, all right, thank you.
Yeah, sorry, one more with Jack.
No. I was just going to say, real quick, on some of this sponsor stuff, you know, you sit in there and you got that drill you thing where they say, your thinking's bad, you better do this or you're going to get drunk, you know. And some of these people, they're scared.
Yeah.
You know, they come in, they go, oh, am I making a bad decision? If I leave this, I'm going to get drunk. Because a lot of fear gets pushed sometimes.
Yeah.
I mean, you know.
It's jealousy and fear. It's people that aren't living their lives sometimes get jealous of the people that are trying to live their lives.
Yeah, I don't sell fear-based to the people I talk to. No fear-based recovery. Yeah.
And Marie, you sound like a great woman, okay?
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Talk to you later. And
bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. And if you just tuned in, that was Marie calling from San Jose. You just tuned in. You're listening to Clean Radio in the studio tonight with Jack Grisham, author, hypnotherapist, and, of course, one of the founding members of the famed band, TSOL.
And I like that one lady said she gives the kids fireworks. Is that what she said?
Yeah, I think something like, you know.
Firecrackers.
And that's the thing about this, about the sobriety gig. It's about finding your own.
Right.
It's about finding your own way and your own fun. And that's why I'm really excited. I'm really excited about, you know, this Wednesday night bowling thing that we're starting at, you know. And Jack, if I know you're really busy, if you want to come down, you know, it's 2 hours of bowling with us. And it's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to be in the Valley. Everybody from the show is going to be there. And just a bunch of sober people bowling on a Wednesday night. And all I wanted when I was drinking, talking about sober fun, do you remember those Blockbuster commercials? You know, make it a Blockbuster night.
Sure.
When I was drinking, all I wanted was a Blockbuster night. You know, and I know that sounds corny, but all I wanted to do was be in. But when the problem is, when you have alcoholism and you have addiction, you can't have a Blockbuster
night.
Because you've sold the TV and the VCR
or
the DVD player.
Yeah.
You know, so there is no Blockbuster night.
Some of this a little bit is finding out once you get sober is who you even are. You know, it takes you a long time. Like, I went back. All the stuff I do now is what I used to do when I was a kid.
Yeah.
Make movies, write, draw, you know, surf, all this stuff. But it took me a while to remember who I was.
Are you a better writer now?
Yeah, I'm getting better every day.
So, and the reason I asked this, because common theme you hear from people, right? You know, I'm not going to be as creative if I stop drinking and using.
Right. And not me.
Yeah, you seem to be on a creative boom.
Yeah, it's better. I get a little sauce in me and the creation's over, unless I'm creating chaos.
And what's Code Blue, a love story about? Which is your new book?
Yeah, it's about some kid, some drifter, loner drifter kid that lives with a single mom, goes to school, has his first sexual experience with a girl, doesn't work out so well. And then she ends up actually overdosing, and he's still in love with her. It's kind of like, you know, little Hamlet, little Romeo and Juliet. You know, one of the lovers dies, and he just has to go a little further and consecrate that love before they bury her.
And that's coming out June 27th?
Well, June 28th, there's a book release party for
it. Where is that?
It's in Long Beach at the Seaport Marina Hotel.
What day of the week is that?
Saturday. It's where they filmed Dexter.
Okay.
You know, it's nice. So we're having a party, and I'm going to read the story. We got a little coffin. It's like a little funeral for the girl Marla.
I'll tell you what. We're going to try to get down there, Patrick. That would be pretty cool. Patrick, who he's the ombudsman of everything that is Clean Radio. We're going to try to get down there if you allow us and maybe film some stuff, because I think that would be wild to see. And
it's interesting.
You know, because I actually read your posts. You know, you're one of the most people's feeds I block. That, you know, not everybody.
Nice.
Just political people. I don't like reading politics.
No.
Even if you're not on my side or the other side, I don't like politics on Facebook. But one of the things I like reading about is you talk about your life on Facebook. You just made two new songs.
Right.
And it's pretty cool. You have some very interesting feeds.
Well, and, you know, on a real quick on this having fun, I went and got hypnotized. How I got into hypnosis was because when I got sober, my ass got tight. I mean, it was seriously. You couldn't have got wider. Yeah, where we're rolling into. But I got hypnotized to try to get me to loosen up a little bit, man. You know, it's like, take it easy. But
it's very true that, you know, a lot of people, when we get sober, we become a little tight.
Right.
We go the total reverse way, and it's finding that balance. It's finding that middle ground. And if you just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio. That's Jack Grisham. I want to get to a quick call. I just want to find out, Heather, let us know what you're doing for sober fun, Heather.
I went to a camping event Memorial Day weekend, and I had a good time, and this coming Wednesday is my naval birthday.
Happy birthday, Heather, in Vermont.
Thank you. And I treated myself with a pedicure and a manicure, and I'm going to let myself have a massage on my birthday.
You know what, Heather? You know, that's amazing. I got to tell you something. You know why I love Heather and a bunch of our calls that call us in is because when Heather first started calling the show, life wasn't this good. And Heather's sober over 15 years, and, you know, stuff comes. Life happens.
Right.
You know, and Heather's been through a divorce in the past year, financials, you know. And Heather, you sharing this stuff is, I love it.
Yeah, I am, you know, I am actually in a very good place. I'm like, man, I got to call when I'm in a good mood and not when I'm, you know.
Well, that's the whole point in sober fun. Remember, that's hashtag sober fun. And the whole reason we're talking about sober fun is because sometimes we talk about issues and they need to be talked about. Last week's guest, Marriott Hartley, was amazing. And, you know, talking about the whole suicide issue. And, you know, sometimes after that, you need to talk about also the life issue and the happiness issue and having the fun issue.
Right.
And we have to put a premium on living our lives and having fun.
Yeah. And what I appreciated is remembering when I was new and how active I was with stuff, because I was in a sober social club, and we had cookouts, and we had dances, and we had, you know, a sober softball league, and, you know, there was good times.
That's amazing, Heather. Thanks for calling, as always.
All right.
Enjoy the mani-pedi.
All right. Bye.
Bye-bye. That was Heather. Let's get to another quick one. Amy, calling from Vancouver, Washington. Tell us what you're doing for fun.
Well, I consider myself now a normie.
Okay.
when Jack mentioned that earlier. But I'm a writer also.
Yes.
I was a born writer, and I've been writing a book about hope, to give other women hope through domestic violence issues. But I'm also a witty person. I love humor. And so what I'm doing for fun is writing my book and promoting a lot of the hidden humor that was in my life that I kind of suppressed during the 11 years of hell. But anyway, I've got an Irma Bombeck / Bill Cosby / The Far Side sense of humor. And it comes out in my writing, so I just...
And you have to promise us, Amy, you have to promise us, because we're running out of time, and I got to let you go, Amy. I promise I'll get you more next week. Let us know. I want to read your stuff when you write it, because you have an amazing sense of humor, and, you know, and I want to see it. And that to anybody that listens to this show, Jack, you know, if you're sober and you've written something, you've sung something, send it to us. You know, don't be scared. I want to hear it, because You were 17, 18 when your band started, right?
Right.
And you just went for it. And sometimes when you get sober, it's a little scary to go for it. And sometimes, like, that tightness comes.
Yeah, I didn't know any better. Yeah. I mean, the one thing I can say, like, to somebody like this, it's writing, don't edit.
Yeah.
Stop editing. Just write it and don't edit. Don't look back. Don't judge it. Don't put it against anything. Just do it.
And don't talk in therapy about it. Just write it, right?
That's right.
And so this, again, so coming up this weekend is really cool, Gay Pride Weekend in Hollywood. Friday night. We're going to be there. We're going to be camped out. KLEAN Radio is going to be camped out at our booth. We'd love for you to come by and say hello. We actually have a game at our booth. Well, I have no idea what this game is going to be. But come down. We're actually giving away a bunch of stuff. We're giving away our doggy shirts and our beanies and our hats. So everybody out there, and especially in the Los Angeles area, come down to Gay Pride. We're coming out there. And we're going to have some fun Friday night, June 5th. Right, Patrick? We're all going to be there. And Demi Lovato is actually the Grand Marshal of the parade. And here's another thing. I got to tell you, it's wild. You know, living out here, and I'm sure you get this, Jack. It's like, I'm from Brooklyn, New York, right? Where you grow up tight. You know, everything is black and white. And, I've been out here for about 10 years. You know, we're talking about fun hiking, right?
Right.
The idea of hiking in Brooklyn, you know, that's a scary thing, you know. But we hike in L.A. We have parades all the time. We have fun out here.
Right.
And there's a good time to be had all over. And I think that's why so many sober people, when they come out here, they stay. Is because there's a great life.
Well, it's nice. It's a lot easier being sober at 68 degrees in the winter.
Yeah.
Than it is 15 foot of snow in the winter.
So that's lapride.org, by the way. Go to it. Come visit us. Jack, so the book comes out June 27th?
Right, June 27th.
And the details are at jackgrisham.com. Is it hardcover, softcover?
Hardcover, illustrated hardcover.
How much are the books?
It's beautiful, $30. They're great.
You know what? I got to tell you, I think it's worth it. Tell us quickly, what's the story about again?
Kid falls in love, has a bad sexual experience. Girl ends up dying. He goes to the mortuary and consecrates whatever he does with their love before they put her away.
And you know what I love about this, Jack? Your sobriety has allowed your uniqueness to come out. I mean, you're so in some fun ways, you have these crazy thoughts, you know, crazy thoughts, and you're not scared to put them out there. You're honest. And you go for it, and you know, you say the hell with it. And I think that's the coolest punk thing ever.
Yeah, it's fun. Sometimes it gets a little confusing to people, because I'll have people go, "Hey, you're 25 years sober. You still drop F-bombs and you write these weird stories." Yeah. It's like, what has that got to do with being sober?
I think that is sober. That is sober.
Exactly.
Doing what you're doing at 25 years sober, taking risks, is the greatest example of what sobriety is and of what sober fun is. And that's hashtag sober fun.
Yes.
That's what you're doing at 25. 25 years sober, Jack. You're hashtagging sober fun. And I want to thank everybody out there that helped put the show together tonight. I want to thank Patrick, Rand, Brian, Tony, Buddy Totten, and everybody out there. I want to thank the best from Integrated PR. That's Monique Moss. And we're going to help you as much as we can. We want you to come in. We're going to buy a couple books. Come back in, you know, and come out there to Long Beach on that Saturday.
Well, we'd love to have you. It's going to be a blast. You have a little string quartet going. It's going to be really nice.
You know what? And, you know, I'm going to tell you, if somebody wants to have sober fun, like you kidnapped that rock star who became a rock star, if anybody wants to be kidnapped that weekend, that sounds really bad. If anybody wants to be taken, no, that sounds bad too. If anybody wants to come with us and have a fun sober time at Jack's book signing, and come with us. We're going to be in Long Beach. That'll be a great time.
Be wonderful. Yeah, and it's a hotel where they film Dexter. Oh, so you can wander around the hotel and see all the Dexter scenes. Kind of cool.
And it's Long Beach. There's amazing things to do out there. And so, yeah, Jack, I want to thank you for coming in again.
Thank you for having me.
And again, I want to thank everybody out there that makes this show possible. I want to thank everybody that finds us on Facebook. Like us. Go to cleanradio.com/Facebook. Again, we're going to be Friday night. We're going to be at the Gay Pride Weekend. Go to lapride.org. Find us our booth. Come play games with us. Get some swag. And come visit us.
Hashtag.
Hashtag. That's hashtag sober fun. And you know what, Jack? I got to tell you, I think this was a lot of fun tonight.
Yeah, thank you very much. I always like coming down and visit.
And so I got to tell you, I love this song because it's all about I want to get better. And it doesn't matter how long you're sober. If you're going through any bit of a rough time, call us. That's 888-601-6040. 888-601-6040. Discussion continues at cleanradio.com.
Are you or someone you care about addicted to drugs or alcohol? Addiction ruins lives and destroys families. Bring an end to the pain and suffering by calling KLEAN Treatment Centers. KLEAN has helped people from around the world break free by not only treating the addiction, but the underlying causes and providing vital aftercare so people can get clean and stay clean with no gimmicks and no false promises. If you need immediate assistance or just have questions, call KLEAN Treatment Centers for guidance. A much better life awaits.